I'd like to thank both Amy and Doug for the invitation to speak here. It's been a great course so far. So you've heard my title that Doug gave me, Does Sphincter of Oddi Dysfunction Even Exist Anymore? This is to remind you of the clinical associations of sphincter of Oddi dysfunction. By far the best studied clinical association is biliary pain after gallbladder surgery. Much less well studied is idiopathic acute recurrent pancreatitis, and we'll talk a bit about that later. And really not studied at all is biliary type pain in a patient with an intact gallbladder. The figure on your right is just to remind you that there are three portions to the sphincter of Oddi. There's a very small portion that surrounds a common channel when there is one. The vast majority of the muscle is the sphincter choledochus around the distal common bile duct, but there also is a small portion around the distal pancreatic duct. All of this muscle is separate from the duodenal wall musculature, although is intimately adjacent to it. So I'm going to talk about classification of suspected biliary sphincter of Oddi dysfunction. The Rome Committee, the Rome 4 Committee, I was chair of the gallbladder and sphincter of Oddi dysfunction committee, has changed the names of the biliary 1 through 3. And we'll talk about the why of that in a few minutes. The biliary, old biliary type 1, as you know, is a patient who must have typical biliary type pain, a dilated bile duct, and this is the modified Milwaukee criteria here of a bile duct greater than 10 millimeters. The original Milwaukee criteria was greater than 12 millimeters, and a liver enzyme elevation. The new Rome name for that is just sphincter of Oddi stenosis. We really wanted to take that out of the suspected biliary SOD category because these patients don't need further testing, they simply need treatment, and we've known that for some time. The old biliary type 2, these are patients who have biliary pain and have less physiologic evidence for bile duct obstruction. It's not as clear cut as the old type 1s. These are patients who have usually one of the above, either a dilated duct or enzyme elevation. Generally, it's the enzyme elevation with pain attack. They are called now suspected biliary SOD because there's really only one category of suspected biliary SOD. And those are ones with rather questionable physiologic evidence. The old type 3, those are the patients with biliary pain only, but no physiologic evidence of bile duct obstruction, I really thought to have functional pain, and therefore are no longer included in this category. So the reasons for this change in classification, as I mentioned, the type 1 cases benefit from sphincterotomy. There's no need for further testing, and indeed, sphincter manometry is often falsely negative in those patients. This is likely stenosis. The type 3 cases really are no longer thought to have sphincter dysfunction, and that's based on the episode trial that was published in JAMA in 2015. It was a large multicenter trial of type 3 patients who are randomized to sham sphincterotomy, dual sphincterotomy, or biliary sphincterotomy alone. And actually, the sham group did the best in terms of clinical outcome. So I think that really put to rest biliary type 3. That leaves us only with uncertainty or suspected diagnosis of sphincter of Oddi dysfunction in the old type 2s. We need to talk about biliary pain. I would argue that many patients who get their gallbladder out for gallbladder dysfunction or have been referred for sphincter manometry really don't have the classic definition of biliary type pain. This is the Rome 4 definition of pain. It's not really different than the Rome 3 or 2. It's pain located in the epigastrium and or the right upper quadrant, also including all of the following. Builds up to a steady level and lasts for 30 minutes or longer. Occurs at different intervals, but not daily, so it's not chronic pain. It's severe enough to interrupt daily activities or lead to an emergency room visit. It's not significantly related to bowel movements and not significantly related to postural change or acid suppression. The supportive criteria for biliary type pain is that it may have associated nausea, vomiting, although the pain is always the primary symptom. It may radiate to the back or the right infrasubscapular region, and it may wake the patients from sleep. It's often not postprandial, although it can be. It should be noted that this biliary pain definition is based on expert opinion only, and it hasn't changed in many years. There actually are no prospective studies of patients who've had symptomatic gallstones, for instance, to say how many of them actually meet this definition. So again, talking about the suspected biliary sphincter of Oddi dysfunction patients, what about those elevated liver enzymes? We believe it's stronger evidence, stronger physiologic evidence, if the enzymes bump up, and they bump up significantly, with a pain attack, although there's only a couple papers that have really looked at that. The level needed is unknown. The original Milwaukee criteria suggested you had to have at least two episodes with elevated enzymes greater than two times the upper limits of normal. The modified criteria said any elevation. So there really isn't good data on what level is needed. Again, the bile duct size that's required, the dilated bile duct, the controversial size cutoff anywhere from 10 to 12. Some experts say anything larger than normal, which would be 8 millimeters. So it's rather controversial. Probably it would be best if you knew what their bile duct size was prior to the cholecystectomy or at the time of the cholecystectomy, so we knew if there was a change, but rarely do we have that information. Remember that bile duct size cannot be counted if the patient's taking chronic narcotics, because that causes significant bile duct dilation. I like to split these suspected biliary sphincter of Oddi dysfunction patients into two categories. The first are the strong patients. They have classic pain. They have significant enzyme elevation with a pain attack. Versus the weak category, their pain's not so typical, and they have maybe chronic mild transaminitis, and many of those perhaps just have fatty liver. So I think it's not as clear-cut as we talk about, even within this one category. The choice for treatment is really empiric biliary sphincterotomy versus further testing with sphincter of Oddi manometry or hepatobiliary scintigraphy, and we'll talk about each of those options. The Rome IV committee recommended this algorithm, that if a patient has suspected biliary SOD based on their labs and their imaging, that they have an endoscopic ultrasound. So that's new, that endoscopic ultrasound now is widely available, and it's thought that it often adds a lot more information in these patients. If you think there's strength of evidence for biliary obstruction is quite good, then they have the diagnosis, and you can decide what treatment you want to do. If the strength of evidence is not so good, then you could consider manometry or hepatobiliary scintigraphy. So it's really put manometry in the optional category, which I think it's been used clinically for many years anyway. Obviously, some of these patients, particularly the weak ones, do have functional biliary pain. So let's talk a little more about what is the value of SO manometry. There's some negative things about, you know, how good is this gold standard. The first is that we know that you get normal manometry in anywhere from 15 to 35% of the old type 1 patients, and we know they almost all respond to sphincterotomy, so it may well have a high false negative rate. We also know in the episode trial, and these were all type 3 patients, that manometry was not predictive of response to sphincterotomy. So these patients were randomized to sham, to biliary sphincterotomy, or dual sphincterotomy, and the outcome of manometry did not predict the response at all. So that suggests manometry is probably not such a good gold standard. The data in favor of manometry is all in the old type 2 or suspected biliary dysfunction patients. There are three small randomized control trials. They're all quite old and quite small. One of them is published in abstract form only. But they all agreed that compared to the sham patients, manometry was predictive of response to sphincterotomy in 70 to 90%. So pretty good predictive, although the sham response rate was fairly high, 35%. There's many case series that are much larger than those small randomized trials, and in case series, the old type 2's really response rate was only about 65%. So that likely included some patients who did not have true sphincter dysfunction. The treatment choice, I should mention that empiric biliary sphincterotomy is commonly performed in both community and academic medical centers, and so it really meets standard of care criteria. So I think if you're worried about standard of care, you don't have to worry about needing manometry for these suspected cases. Some people say don't do manometry because it increases your risk of pancreatitis, but that idea was really put to rest many years ago. This is one paper that helped put it to rest. This was a single center study of patients who, some of their patients underwent ERCP with manometry, some just underwent ERCP alone for suspected sphincter of Oddi dysfunction. They had a very high pancreatitis rate, 26%. Remember, this was in the era before prophylactic pancreatic duct stents and before indomethacin. At that same center, their pancreatitis rate for bile duct stones was very low, 3%. So they also found that pancreatitis was increased when a sphincterotomy was performed and increased if any injection into the duct was made. So the conclusion is that it's the diagnosis of suspected sphincter of Oddi dysfunction, not the manometry, that increases the risk of the procedure. So if you continue to, if you perform ERCP and you go for empiric sphincterotomy, remember you still are have very high risk patients. I think this is a fascinating slide. I got this from Greg Cote. He got the data really from Wilson Cook, who's the major manufacturer of manometry catheters in the United States. If you look from 2006 to 2014, all of those colors are different states. And you can see that there was already a marked decline in the popularity of manometry, a lot decreased there, and that was before the episode trial was published. It wasn't published until 2015. If you look at the picture on the right, it's fascinating to see that six states out of 50 did two-thirds of the manometry sales. So that would also make you wonder, is this really a real entity? It only occurs in some states or in some regions and not others. And 13 states that originally were buying manometry catheters quit buying them entirely after 2014. So obviously manometry is waning. What about the value of hepatobiliary scintigraphy? This is attractive because it's non-invasive. Theoretically, it makes sense that if you could measure bile transit into duodenum, that would be a good measure of sphincter dysfunction. The problem is the data is pretty gray. It's very difficult to assess the value of this exam because varying techniques have been used in the studies available. In this, some studies, it was, in fact, the majority of studies, it was compared to manometry as a gold standard. But we've already said that manometry may not be a very good gold standard, so we don't know how to interpret those studies. In the few studies where it was compared to response to sphincterotomy, so clinical improvement, it seems to work pretty well in patients who have very strong evidence for sphincter dysfunction, the old type 1 patients and some of the very strong type 2s, but it just doesn't perform well in the ones where you don't have good evidence. And those are the ones where we need a test to perform well. So it's not clear what the role of hepatobiliary scintigraphy is. It's certainly not wrong to do it, but we need more data on this. So what are the treatment options for biliary SOD? Conservative treatment has been reported in several papers around the world. Nortriptyline, trimethylbutene, which is only available in Europe. Nitrates, reassurance even, was reported in one paper to have some success. Obviously, conservative therapy is always safe. Biliary sphincterotomy, as we mentioned, in randomized controlled trials, in the very small three randomized controlled trials that are available, shows that manometry is predictive of response in 70 to 90% of the biliary type 2 patients, or the suspected sphincter dysfunction patients. But you should know that there are no outcome studies of empiric sphincterotomy. So we don't have a single case series even of empiric sphincterotomy, even though that's widely performed for suspected sphincter dysfunction, to know what the response rate is. And you should also remember that this is still a very high-risk ERCP, even in the era of prophylactic pancreatic stents and indomethacin use, the pancreatitis rate is still in the 10 to 15% range. Okay, so very briefly, what about sphincter of Oddi dysfunction in patients with an intact gallbladder? Does this even occur? There are very, very few studies on this. They're really poor quality. What we can learn from these studies is that if you have an intact gallbladder and you do a sphincterotomy or manometry and sphincterotomy, you're less likely to respond to that sphincterotomy than in the similar patient who's had a prior cholecystectomy. At best, it appears that up to 40% may have a clinical benefit, although recall that a 40% clinical benefit is not much different than a placebo response in the episode trial. So the conclusion that ERCP, manometry, or direct empiric sphincterotomy should not be performed for possible sphincter Oddi dysfunction in patients with an intact gallbladder unless they're involved in a clinical trial. So now I'm going to turn to pancreatic sphincter Oddi dysfunction. Is it real? Historically, there was some mention that pancreatic type pain patients may be pancreatic type 3, and you should proceed with manometry in those patients. There's really no role for ERCP, manometry, or sphincterotomy in pain-only patients. So I'm really only talking about documented idiopathic acute recurrent pancreatitis. And as Darwin pointed out, you really can't call it idiopathic unless you've done careful imaging studies, including endoscopic ultrasound. They have to have more than one episode. Remember that many patients with one episode of pancreatitis will not have another episode for 15 years, so you should not be subjecting them to ERCP and manometry. You also have to have a negative EUS to rule out other things, such as subtle small duct chronic pancreatitis, ampullary adenomas, etc. However, in a patient who's had multiple attacks of documented clear-cut idiopathic acute recurrent pancreatitis and they're anxious to try to do something, you can offer them ERCP with manometry. This is one of the few situations where manometry still is indicated and necessary, and the data for that really comes from this one study. This study was published in Gastroenterology in 2012. It's from Indiana. It was actually, the study was started in the late 1990s, so it went on for many, many years. It's hard to collect these patients. And the study is far from perfect. They really had two arms. One were patients, all of the patients had documented idiopathic acute recurrent pancreatitis, and all of them had more than one episode. But the arm of patients who had normal manometry, they randomized them to biliary sphincterotomy versus sham, and there was no benefit to biliary sphincterotomy in those patients. The one thing they found is that the ones that had normal manometry had a better long-term prognosis than the ones with abnormal manometry. So the ones with abnormal manometry had many more attacks and were more likely to progress on to chronic pancreatitis. The way they managed their abnormal manometry arm, unfortunately, there was no sham treatment arm. So we really still don't have an answer whether sphincterotomy benefits these patients at all. Instead, the patients were randomized to biliary sphincterotomy alone versus dual pancreatic and biliary sphincterotomy. For many years, most interventionalists, including myself, believed you had to cut that pancreatic portion of the sphincter. Remember, I showed you the picture that it was separate. So they looked at that, biliary versus dual. And the surprising thing from this study was that dual sphincterotomy was not superior to biliary sphincterotomy alone and clearly is riskier in terms of restenosis rates. At best, the benefit was 50%. So if I see a patient who's had idiopathic acute recurrent pancreatitis and is desperate to do something, they've had multiple attacks, I tell them at best the chance that we can help you is 50% and the risk of getting procedure-induced pancreatitis is 15%. They have to be motivated to hear those kind of numbers. So what are the take-home points for sphincter Oddi dysfunction? Suspected biliary sphincter Oddi dysfunction types 1 through 3 are eliminated. That's because type 1 is really not suspected. There's good physiologic evidence of bile duct obstruction, and type 3 is not real. It's functional abdominal pain syndrome. Empiric biliary sphincterotomy for suspected sphincter Oddi dysfunction is accepted in probably very reasonable and strong cases. Although if you have a weak suspected case, I would consider additional testing with manometry and or hepatobiliary scintigraphy. There really should be no consideration of sphincter Oddi dysfunction in patients with an intact gallbladder unless they're involved in a clinical trial. And you can consider manometry and biliary sphincterotomy alone, not dual sphincterotomy, in motivated patients who've had documented idiopathic acute recurrent pancreatitis, more than one episode, frequent episodes, and they're desperate for care. So in conclusion, the question I was asked to answer is, does sphincter Oddi dysfunction even exist anymore? The answer is yes, it does exist, albeit in a simpler categorization system, and sphincter Oddi manometry is barely hanging on. Thanks.